Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 86 of the Rock and Roll Beer Guy podcast. Please don't forget to check out the Patreon page. Go to patreon.com/rockandrollbeerguy, and you can sign up to gain access to exclusive interviews that I did at Psycho Las Vegas with bands like Andrew WK and CKY, Red Fang, plus other exclusive content and merchandise. In this episode, I talked to the legendary Larry Kenney. He is a voice actor that's done the voice of Lion-O from the Thundercats back in the 80s. He was Bluegrass and Silverhawks. He was Count Chocula. He still is Count Chocula. He's done work with Red Dead Redemption 2. I mean, the guy is a legend, and it was a great honor speaking with him. We talk a little bit about that, his career, what it's like to be a voice actor in comparison to being a physical actor, and a few other things. I had a great time talking to him, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Cheers.
Hello,
is this Larry Kenney?
Yes, is this Eddie Torres?
Yes, it is. How are you today, sir?
I'm good, man. I'm glad to finally talk to you. I'm sorry I had to put you off the last time.
Oh, no worries. I know you're a busy man. I've been seeing your name pop up in several new credits.
Yeah. So, you're in Long Beach, huh?
Yep, Long Beach, California. It's been raining the pouring really for the last few days, which is a rarity for California.
I know. My daughter lives in Malibu, and just barely escaped the fires. Most of her neighborhood was destroyed, but her house is fine.
Yeah, I was going to ask. I mean, that was pretty devastating, and now with the rain, it's got all this mudslides going, and
seems like it's always something out there, right?
Yeah,
fires, mudslides.
Mother Nature does not want us to be here.
Yeah. Beautiful place, though.
Yeah, for sure.
So what do you want to talk about, Eddie?
Well, I just wanted to, I mean, I've been a fan of yours for a long time. You know, we met at one of the cons in Florida, at one of the super cons.
Oh, we did.
Yeah.
Oh, great.
Yeah, a while back. We actually ran into you at the food area, I suppose, I think, in a hotel after the con, because I'm good friends with Dana Snyder and everything, so we were hanging out with him.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so we were probably drunk.
Yes, we were drunk on Disney, actually.
Dana's crazy.
No, he's great. He's a really, really nice guy as well.
He is a great guy, yeah. But he's nuts.
Well, I guess it's needed. No, it's needed for the, you know, the characters he plays and everything.
Exactly. Exactly. He'd say the same thing about me. And when I say he's nuts, that's in a good way, you know.
For sure, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
So how's everything been? I know that I saw that you were recently in the new Red Dead Redemption game. And your
which one?
Red Dead Redemption 2, is that correct?
Oh, is that the name of it? You know, they didn't even tell me the name of the thing. If that's the one I just finished working on it a few months ago. Yeah, that does sound familiar. The one from Rockstar Games.
Yeah, it's a Western.
I didn't know they had named it yet, because when I did the work for them, it was an unnamed project.
Oh, okay.
And had to sign an agreement that you won't tell anybody anything about it, you know. But now I guess I can. Must be. Have they released it yet?
Oh yeah, yeah. It's been out. Oh. Yeah, they The game was up for an award for Game of the Year, but unfortunately got knocked down by another one, God of War.
Wow.
But it was up there. I mean, the Video Game Awards made a big deal. They had a whole, like, musical performance for it and everything. It was great.
Yeah. Well, I missed that whole thing. I'll have to. But did you see my name on the credits? Is that how you know?
Yeah, you're playing a character named, I think it's like JB Cripps or something like that, which I think is...
That's it. Yeah. JB Cripps, yeah. JB Cripps, well, yeah. I'll be damned. I didn't even know it was out yet.
Yeah,
thank you.
I wanted to ask you how that whole thing kind of goes. I have heard, some other voice actors having trouble with companies that haven't really been responsive or having trouble with getting payments and everything. So I want to know how your experience was on that.
Oh, my experience is great with them. In fact, I've done work for Rockstar Games before. Grand Theft Auto 4, I think, was on that one.
Yeah, you were the radio announcer.
I've always enjoyed working for them. Yeah, yeah. I've always enjoyed working, but this last time was really one of the more interesting things I've ever done personally, because I got to do that motion capture.
Oh, wow!
You know what
okay.
that is, right? Yeah, they had me in a suit with, like, 100 electrodes on me, and it was so much fun to do, and just amazing. I had never done that before. You know, the technology is incredible.
Yeah, I haven't played the game much. I played a little bit when it first came out, but so I assume then the character kind of represents you in real life, the way you look, or you're just the movements.
No, they don't use your face.
Oh, okay.
They just use your body, just the movements. It's like they did for like Avatar and the Planet of the Apes movies, where they, things like that.
Yeah.
Where. It's just the movement they want, but I mean, you're there all day, and it's really fascinating. The technology is amazing.
Interesting. So you did go into the actual studio for this, because a lot of new voice acting happens through email now. Like, people have studios at home and they record and then send it off.
Mm-hmm.
So you actually went in.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. Yeah. I had to go in for this one.
Yeah.
Most of what I do is not. It's not email. I email auditions to my agent, but not stuff that's going to be on the air because the quality is not as good.
Right.
I know there are a lot of people I know who have home studios and stuff, and they send things out. But I never have done that. I don't care to do work from home.
Yeah, it's not as fun. I mean, you need to motivate yourself to actually get up and do it when you're at home. Because
yeah, that's right. That's my problem.
Yeah, if you get up and go to a studio, you're kind of forced to, you're like, hey, I'm here, I have to do it. Well, when you're at home, you're like, well, I could also just relax on the couch.
Sure, that's right. Yeah. See what's on Dr. Phil.
Yeah. And so, how would you compare doing, because, if anyone's listening that isn't aware already, you did the voice for Lion-O for the Thundercats, and you also did work for the Silverhawks, and I want to talk to you about that too later, but the difference between recording back then as opposed to now, what do you feel are one of the major differences, aside from just, ease of the technology?
The major difference now for the actor is that you work alone now almost all the time. And up until, 15 years or so ago, you'd do ensemble work. Even if you were doing a radio commercial, a local radio commercial, if there were more than one person on it, you'd be together when you did it.
Mm.
And when we did the original Thundercats back in the 80s, and Silverhawks and Tiger Sharks and all those Rankin Bass holiday specials like Star for Jeremy and Life and Adventures of Santa Claus, all of those, we worked always together. In like five or six people, the whole cast together. And now, most often, you find yourself as an actor in a little booth by yourself. They record one person at a time. I don't know why. I've never asked why, but it's not nearly as much fun, And I think that actors naturally work better, produce a better product when we're together, bouncing off each other,
For sure.
For me, that's the main difference. The technology hasn't changed much in the last 20 years or so. So for recording voices. I mean, you know.
Yeah, the quality has gotten better, but the technology is still kind of the same idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So for me, the big difference, like I said, is not being together with other actors when you're recording.
Yeah, I wonder.
Even when
go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Even when in 2011 or 2012, when we did a reboot from Warner Brothers reboot of Thundercats, they flew me out to Warner Brothers Ranch in California, and I walked in and I was just chatting up the director, waiting for the other actors to arrive. And at one point, he said, "Well, you know, we better get started." Because I said, "Where's everybody else?" And he said, "No, it's just going to be you." So I'm standing in this huge studio with six microphones, and there's nobody at the other ones. Yeah, not nearly as much fun.
Yeah, I find that kind of odd. I mean, you would think that you would get a better performance out of a natural feeling conversation, whereas when you're by yourself, you have to kind of envision that you're in front of someone talking to them and how they're going to react.
Right. That's right.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't like that. I feel that, you know, it's the same with music. Like when you're in a band together, you get together and you jam. It's not, you know, it's not the same when you're emailing each other files like, "Oh, here's the bass and figure it out." You know,
that's right.
Wow. And so, you know, speaking of ensemble casts and having fun, I mean, I'm sure you're aware. I've found online like old clips of Thundercats, like bloopers, like recordings that happened offhand. Like, so yeah. Was that something common back then? Like just guys having fun?
Well, the only difference is between then and now is you didn't have the internet so that the world could hear it. You know, anytime you have actors together, whether it's for an animated, you know, a cartoon show or a movie or a play, even, you know, in rehearsal, there's always going to be outtakes. You know, yeah. Somebody will blow a line, the other person will say something funny about it. You know, but back in the 80s when that happened, and the only people who ever heard it were us, the actors, and the recording engineer and the producer. Although we always suspected, and it turns out to be true, that most recording engineers who were involved in, you know, things like that, would keep outtakes. And I guess, you know, like, let's say they're having a Christmas party, you know, and the guy might say, "Hey, you guys want to hear something funny? We're recording Thundercats, you know, and I'm the engineer, and well, there's funny stuff that happens, you know." So that's the only time you'd hear it. And then all of a sudden, here comes the internet, and it's all over the place.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's what are your thoughts on that? As you know, you're one of the few guests I've had have been around working since the 70s, and I wanted to know your thoughts on how technology has changed. Like, what are your thoughts on the fact that you pretty much have access to everything now?
You mean on the internet?
Yeah, on the internet, like you can get any like that, like you were just saying that your outtakes are available for everyone to listen to. Like, do you feel like that's kind of an invasion of privacy, or are you cool with it?
Well, I'm cool with it. Yeah, I don't, you know, it doesn't bother me at all. I tell you, when I first found out about it, the outtakes being on the web, my son said to me one day, of course, he was in the computers before my wife and I were. He said, "Hey, Dad, have you heard the outtakes, or do you know that there are outtakes of Thundercats on the internet?" And I said, "Well, let me hear them." So he played them for me, and I thought, "Oh my God, oh no!" Because I've always been very protective of the legacy of Thundercats. You know, I know what it means to people, and to a lot of people, it was more than just a TV show. You know, it was kind of helped them find a moral compass. They told me that over the years, and so I said, "You know what? Gosh, I'm now." Now those kids are going to hear that and hear Lionel and everybody cussing and all. And my son said, "Dad, those kids are like 30 years old now."
Exactly. You know,
yeah, exactly. And I said, "Well, okay, fine. But if I get any bad letters, you know," and I never did. So,
yeah, of course not. Actually, as for me, for example, like I grew up on Thundercats. I'm 37. Jeez, I forgot my age. I'm 37 now. And I heard those outtakes and I thought it was great because it showed that there are humans behind those characters, you know?
Yeah, that's right.
And I can relate. I relate now as the same as I did when I was a child, that I'm like, all right, see, this is cool.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And you, we mentioned Silverhawks, and that to me was one of my biggest shows. Actually, more so than Thundercats, and I feel like that's one of those shows that didn't get as much love. You know, like they've rebooted Thundercats. It's also, you know, it's still in the mainstream pop culture. You walk into Hot Topic, there's Thundercats stuff. So, but Silverhawks never got that love, and I don't know why.
Nobody knows. I mean, you never know when you're making a cartoon show or any kind of a show or like I said before, a movie or a film. You know if they're right. You can tell if the writing is good or not when you're recording it. You know, we know what's good writing. We know what's not good writing. And we knew the animation was fantastic when we saw it because we recorded for a few months before we saw it. You always record the voice first for animation. And now I've forgotten what you asked me.
Well, I was saying I wonder why Silverhawks really didn't get that attention or that.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's right. I really have no idea. I mean, it was on the same network, and I thought it was a very good show too. I just, you know, some things catch on and some things don't. You just never know.
Yeah, I still have the VHS. It's like a yellow VHS of Silverhawks. It's great.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know if they ever put Silverhawks out on DVD.
I don't know. I don't think I've seen it. I did see some toys, which I plan on buying in one of those retro toy stores. And I was like, man, when I have the $150 that they want for the original set, I think I'm going to pick that up.
Yeah. You know, I wish I had kept some of that stuff or even had some of that stuff. I recall when we finished Thundercats, mm-hmm. The last couple of recording sessions, They brought in, the producers brought in boxes of animation cells.
Oh, wow.
And they said, you know, guys, take whatever you want, you know, because we're just going to throw them away anyway. Mm-hmm. So I grabbed a couple of them, but, you know, and now, of course, there are no animation cells anymore. I mean, we don't use animation cells anymore because it's all computerized.
Right, yeah.
For people who don't know, the animation cells are the drawings on plastic or whatever it was that are then used to, you know, to animate the thing.
Yeah, it's like frame by frame, right? They, you know, they have to have every little frame. Yeah.
Yeah. So there are thousands of them for every minute, you know.
Yeah, I mean, and that's a hot commodity like conventions. And I mean, I know you do several conventions, you know, throughout the year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that would be
cool. I usually do. Yeah, I see them around too. I mean, people often ask me to autograph them, you know.
Yeah. So what would you say is the major difference between working on a show and working on a video game? Because, like you said, you've worked on several video games at this point. So what would, for you, how do you prepare differently? Because I know you have to do, like, little nuance noises for, I guess, video games that you probably wouldn't do in a show.
Most of the time, video games, it's more like, you know, they'll say, give me five grunts, you know. Now give me five that are just, you know, just a little like that. Now give me some that are, you're roaring. So you spend a lot of time doing that, you know, different kinds of laughs and things like that.
Man, that's got to be tedious.
Well, it's part of the fun, you know, creating stuff like that and being able to do that kind of stuff. Instead of just reading words, you know.
Yeah. And they're getting more creative when it comes to those games. Like, I recently played the new Spider-Man game, and apparently there's two different recordings of pretty much every piece of dialogue. Where if he's just walking, it sounds normal, and then if he's swinging around the city, the same conversation's happening, he sounds stressed out. Like, he's, you know, talking louder and more, like...
Really?
Yeah, it's... So I assume they're going to start doing that for a lot more games. I would believe, yeah. If you had a dream project that you wanted to work on, what would that be?
The Simpsons.
Oh, okay.
Those people are making $1 million a week, you know? literally $1 million an episode.
That's nuts.
Simpsons, of course, that would have been, you know, that's the biggest animated show ever in history. It's one of the top longest running television shows in history of any kind. So that would have been great. I mean, I don't know. I don't really sit around and think, oh, gosh, I wish I had done that. I wish I had done this. I've had my share, you know, and I've been very lucky. And I love doing it. So, plus, there's no heavy lifting.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to ask you that as well. Like, have you ever had any desire to do actual physical acting as opposed to just voice acting?
No, I tried it back in the 70s when I first came to New York. They asked me to do a soap opera, and I played a waiter on on a thing called the Edge of Night, which doesn't exist anymore. And after that, I told my agent, no more on camera things. Because as a voiceover actor, I was used to, you know, let's say at 10 o'clock going to one studio and I'll be there for 20 minutes, half an hour tops. Then you go to another studio and for an audition, then you go to another studio. When you do on camera television or movies or even worse probably, it's waiting around, just hours and hours of sitting around waiting for, you know, people to get their makeup on and for them to mark mark everybody's locations and things like that. And I don't enjoy that at all. I don't enjoy waiting around. So I said, no more on camera for me.
Yeah. Yeah. I can. That's true. It's very much like that. I did a couple of extra spots here and there. I did the movie Miami Vice and Too Fast and Too Furious and Bad Boys 2. And it was just, I think Miami Vice was the worst one. We were there for 12 hours. And we were just for one scene of us in the restaurant.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was just a lot of cuts because they had to record dialogue and people were making sounds with their forks and their plates and stuff. And you can't have any of that going on. So every time you would hear a fork, it's like, oh, cut, start over, reset. It's like, oh, geez.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah. So I can understand. I mean, I've always had a desire to dip my toes in the voice acting world, but never, I always find it difficult to, I guess, actually open the door. Like, I don't know how that all works out. I guess you just send your resume or your reel or portfolio or whatever to agents, I guess. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. It's a tough business to break into. It really is very tough. For people who want to do voice acting, when they ask me how to get into it, first of all, I tell them, look, I haven't broken into the business for 60 years. So, in other words, I broke into the business back in 1963 in radio. So, and then, you know, did television and a couple of films and stuff like that. And so... What was the question again? I'm sorry.
No, it's okay.
Don't get old. Don't get old, man. It's a bitch, I'm telling you.
Oh, man. No, I was just saying, just breaking into the business, and you mentioned, you know, it's been a long time since you did that.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes, of course. That was the question. because I started in radio, and it was a natural progression into voiceover because, you know, you're doing commercials on the air. And then, so you're getting some experience, you know, in doing voiceover. Mm-hmm. If you're a disc jockey sitting there playing records and then you'll read a commercial, you know, that's voiceover.
Right.
So that's how I broke into it. And as for somebody who's not at all in the entertainment industry at all to get into it, my only suggestion is that, If you really want to get in the voiceover business, you need to take classes, and it's easy to find. You Google, you know, voiceover acting in, let's say, you know, Long Beach or wherever. You know, of course, you're near L.A. So you Google and you'll see all kinds of classes being offered at different studios and places like that. And so you check them out, and what you want to find is one where, most of them are like a couple hours a night for maybe three nights a week, you know, for a couple of months, something like that. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how much they charge you, but probably maybe $1,000. I don't know. But anyway, during the course of the semester, if you want to call it that, you want to find one where they bring in to the class. They bring in advertising agency people. They bring in producers, maybe voiceover actors, you know, that you can talk to and you can ask questions of. And so it's more than just, you know, one person standing there and teaching you how to be a voiceover, which you can't really do anyway. So yeah. You want to make sure that you, that they make it available to you, those people I talked about. And then the most important thing is at the end of the course, you need to leave there with what we used to call a demo reel, but we don't use reel-to-reel tape anymore. Mm-hmm. But a demo CD, let's say, which they help you put together during the course of the course. And then once you have that, a CD that shows what you can do, shows some of your, the extent of your talents, your range, then you can go to an agent and try to get them to sign you. Of course, nowadays, too, with the Internet, you can get in the business by just sending somebody an email, like you said, with your voice on it. But I don't know how that would work. Again, I've been in the business so long, I don't know what the new thing is. You know?
Yeah, I think it's got to be the Internet at this point. I mean, I'm sure they're still accepting CDs and whatnot. But, I always wondered what those classes would teach you, because I feel that when it comes to voice acting and actual acting, it's not something you can really teach all that much. You have to have a voice. You have to have the ability to express it.
Yeah. You can't teach the talent or the ability. You can teach microphone technique, how to approach agencies and things like that, you know. But you can't, like you said, you can't really teach somebody to be good. You know what I mean?
Sure. Yeah. And I've always thought voice acting to be way more difficult than physical acting, just because you have to kind of envision or imagine what's happening, since there is no animation in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
Do they do like double takes where you'll do a take and then they'll animate it and then you kind of re-record anything while watching what's been animated at all?
Very rarely, because it's very difficult to, the reason that you do the voice first before you do the animation is the other way around would be almost impossible for actors to stand there and watch the screen and then try to match the lips, or in my case, the beak,
right.
You know? So it's almost impossible. Now, occasionally, yeah, things would happen where I come into a recording session, they'd say, by the way, Larry, last week when we did this thing, we decided we didn't like the way you said this thing or something, you know.
Yeah.
And they might have you redo that one line or that one word, or a lot of times you go back in and put, we used to have what we call grunts and groan sessions, where the entire, you had finished doing the episode, but they needed, after listening to it, they decided they needed some more responses during the show to what's happening on screen, you know. Mm-hmm. So like I said earlier, they might say, okay, give me five, okay, here's what's happening. You just got stabbed in the back and you're falling down. You know, do that five times.
Wow.
So that happens. Listen, Eddie, I've got about five more minutes.
Sure, yeah, no problem.
For you?
Yeah,
okay,
no problem.
Good.
Real quick, I just, you know, wanted to ask you, since this is a thought of mine, I used to sing in a band and I use my voice for the podcast. So what do you do to take care of your voice? Because I've heard mixed stories between, you know, don't eat chocolate, or, you know, right before you record, or make sure you use honey and ginger. Like, what are your methods?
I don't have any of those methods. I don't do anything like that. I don't warm up before, you know. Some very few actors I've seen do it, but some still do those scales, you know.
Right.
I've never done any of that kind of stuff. I don't need it, you know. So it saves me time.
Right, sure. And do you never smoke cigarettes or anything like that either?
I used to smoke cigars and pipes.
Okay.
But never cigarettes.
So I feel like a lot of actors that smoke a lot, their voices get deeper and raspier, but that's also sometimes desired for whatever character they're playing, you know?
I suppose. Sure. But then the object is to be able to sound like that without ruining your voice. In other words, acting, you know?
Yeah.
In other words, instead of hiring let's find an actor who has a deep, gravelly voice. It's, let's use this professional actor who knows how to make his voice sound like that. Yeah.
Just a couple more questions here. So you do a lot of convention scenes. Do you know, on average, how many like voicemail recordings you've been asked to do for people?
For their telephones?
Yeah.
I don't keep track, but it's quite a few. Yeah. It's funny because, you know, in the convention, at the Comic-Con, it's very loud. Mm-hmm. And so we usually try to find a door near my booth where I can go outside and record these things for people.
Oh, man. And then my fiance wanted to know if you had to pick another actor to do your legendary role as Lion-O, if you could envision that, who would it be?
Well, the only other, I mean, I had never thought about that, and I wouldn't want anybody else to do it, but sure. I always thought that Peter Newman, who played Tigra, his voice and mine were fairly similar, I thought.
Hmm. Yeah.
So he could probably have done Lion-O, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
But I'm glad he didn't. I'm glad I did.
For sure, yeah. You've created a legacy, and I wanted to thank you, you know, for taking time to speak with me, for everything you've done, and yeah. I appreciate your work.
Well, thank you, Eddie. That's very nice of you. I appreciate it, and I enjoyed talking to you.
I enjoyed it as well. Thanks so much. You know, follow your adventures. You have Instagram or social media or anything like that?
I'm on Facebook. No. I'm just Facebook. I don't. I'm not a Twitterer, and I don't do Instagram.
Do you have any?
They can find me on
Facebook. Huh? Yeah.
What's that?
No. I was going to say, do you have any projects coming up that people can keep an eye on?
Well, the thing about my business, our business, is that you don't know very far in advance. I mean, I might get a call later today from my agent, and he might say, Monday at 2:00, you go in and audition for this thing, you know. Mm-hmm. And then you find out probably the day after, like Tuesday, whether you got the job or not. And then the job usually happens about 3 or 4 days after that. So you don't really know more than a week or so in advance.
I see.
What you're going to be doing. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and you don't
so
have anything.
I can't tell you.
You don't have anything.
I can't tell
on.
You what I'm going to be doing 2 months from now or whatever.
Yeah.
I can tell you what I did yesterday. I did a new Skittles commercial.
Oh, nice.
And I've been doing Skittles for, I guess, 20 years. I don't know. I'm the guy at the end of all the Skittles commercials.
You're the taste of rainbow?
You know, the guy that says, feel the rainbow, taste the rainbow.
Ah.
Yeah, that's me.
That's great, man. That's great.
Well, and I still do Cocoa Puffs. I'm still the voice of Sonny the Cocoa Puffs bird. After about 40 years, I've been doing him. And it's Count Chocula. I've been doing Count Chocula for 40 years.
It's crazy that those cereals are still around.
Yes, it is.
You know, I mean, Count Chocula is like a cult icon right now.
Yeah, I know.
That's nuts.
I know.
Well, it's job security for you, so that's good.
You got it.
All right. Well, thanks again. Have a lovely day.
My pleasure, Eddie. Nice talking to you.
Nice talking to you. Bye-bye.
Okay, buddy. Bye-bye.
Tally-ho! Wings of silver, birds of steel.